Sequestration has had a big effect on both federal spending, but also all the businesses and partnerships that flow from that. And so it's been very challenging because it's forced people to rethink their plans. But there was a saying I used when I was in the federal government, never waste a good budget crisis. So scarcity of resources forces you to think about priority. You can't afford to do all the things that you might want to do. So in the healthy upside of that is it forces you to prioritize. Well, that's the real focus behind the top 20 critical security controls. I say in this business, there's a near infinite list of good things to do. Right? You can get them from every consultant, checklist, benchmark, supplier. There's no shortage of good things that you could be doing, but you can't afford to do them all, even in the best of times. The real issue is, what steps do you need to take first? What will provide you the most value? What will give you the opportunity to build a continuous understanding of the risks that you face and do it in a way that's market friendly, that is, it can be purchased off the shelf, supported with the people that you have, and put into an environment that's manageable with all the other IT issues that you have to deal with. So I think the upside of thinking about sequestration is it forces us to prioritize. That gives us the opportunity to then say, well, how will I prioritize? How do I bring folks together that really understand the problem and can state it in a way that I can align my scarce resources against it?
So we can't afford the approach that buys every new tool or every new bright, shiny object on the market and deploys it on the system. First, that's expensive. Second, it's duplicative. Third, often these things are not compatible. So what you want is a holistic approach that looks at all the elements of your network, inside and out, that is constantly aware of what's going on in the network so you can see where the threats are and where they're coming from, and then makes the appropriate investment based upon the dynamics and the requirements of your particular network and your particular mission. And that's not only more efficient, but it's more economical, which is important when you're managing a difficult budget environment.
I mean, there are a few probably very fortunate enterprises that have almost unlimited resources, but most of us have to live with a lot less than that. So the issue then boils down fairly directly to that risk management equation. What are the things that you have to protect most? How do you use your limited resources to protect those things that really matter? And this becomes very quickly, I think, a manageable set of issues for most organizations. You clearly want to know, for example, what your principal and most privileged users are doing. Who's in your network? What are they doing? What might be contrary to policy? What is clearly damaging? And how can you shut it off quickly? Similarly, you look at systems and information. You want to make sure that you can identify which systems and which information assets are most important and begin to protect those. And if you start with individual business lines and you kind of model the assets, model the business value process in an end-to-end way, I think you can arrive at what we refer to as a business impact analysis or business impact assessment. That really begins to define the key assets that make that business a valuable part of your enterprise or your mission and allow you to begin to focus on the assets that matter most.
I think there are a couple of fundamental things you can do. And then there's some more intangible things that I think security organizations, successful security organizations do. The most fundamental is, taking the highest priorities, the things that create the most risk to your organizations, and prioritize them and start working through those issues. Certainly the SANS top 20 are very well founded, and I think if any organization that can say that they've addressed the SANS top 20 is going to be in pretty good shape from a security perspective. But even that, I think most organizations probably have a challenge when you look at the enormity of that. But you have to prioritize them and you have to work through them. That's the very tangible. Some of the more intangibles is letting the security people within your organization, giving them some flexibility to be creative.
Yeah, I think one of the challenges that security professionals are going to have to wrap their heads around is that budgets are not likely to grow the way that we've been accustomed to in the past. I think security may grow as a percentage of the IT budget, but budgets seem to be getting tighter. So, for example, how do we take functions that we're used to throwing a lot of labor at and substantially automate those functions so that we free up both the people resources and the dollar resources to be able to ask for something additional. Because we're going to have to fulfill what is a constantly growing charter in terms of security obligations. And I think the resources are going to be tight for a long time.